Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is April 9th, 2017. It is Sunday of the Passion, Palm Sunday. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is Palm Sunday, April the 9th, Sunday, 2017. This hymn was written by Theodolf of Orleans. He wrote it in 820, and he was imprisoned, and he sang it. St. Louis heard him singing it when he was in prison, and he set him free. All glory, Lord, and honor to thee, Redeemer King. A very old hymn written by Theodolf under Charlemagne and St. Louis.
Thank you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Be doing the readings today.
First reading for today is from the 50th chapter of Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with the word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen to those who have taught. The Lord God has opened my ear. I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Becky Dimitroff will do the psalm.
Thank you.
same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
As our pastor, Pastor John Pollock, is ascending the pulpit to be reading the Passion Palm Sunday Gospel for today. Passion means passivity. Jesus accepted God's will.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 21st chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Turn to the Gospel in front of your today's reading. When they had come near Jerusalem and entered Bethage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her, and tie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowd were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements to share with you. First of all, of course, as I said, this is the beginning of Holy Week, and so we will have services on Monday, Thursday at 2 and 7 p.m., and then again on Good Friday at 2 and 7 p.m. So, as I mentioned in Sunday school class, without Monday, Thursday, Good Friday, there is no Easter. Without Jesus suffering and death, there is no resurrection and ascension. Without Jesus' death, there's no forgiveness of sin and promise of everlasting life. And so this year, I hope, is a year that we buck the national trend, which is to not come to service on Monday, Thursday, and Good Friday. That's one reason why we're not reading a Passion today. We will read it Good Friday. Today is Palm Sunday. So please join us Thursday and Friday as we observe those two important events in the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. Also, I think it's been mentioned, for those of you who are familiar with the kitchen, our good friend Bill Spaulding, who always ran the dishwasher, not just on Tuesday for Kiwanis and Fridays for Rainbow Table, but oftentimes during Yuletide and other events we'd have here, he would come even though he didn't have to. His memorial service will be Saturday at 10:30 at St. Raphael's Church. One of his requests was that I help in the service, so I will be officiating the service with the horseman from St. Ray's. So I'd like to see as many people from St. John as can make it to show our appreciation to his wife and family for all that time that Bill would volunteer cleaning up the dishes after we would have a meal. So again, it's 10:30 at St. Ray's this coming Sunday. Now I ask that you give your attention to the
his miracles. It was now time for the Jewish Passover, and again, Jesus was surrounded by a large host of devoted followers. As he prepared to enter Jerusalem for the Holy Festival, the people shouted their praise for all they had witnessed through him. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna! Blessed is the King of Israel.
Defiant religious leaders said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples. Tell them to silence their voices." But Jesus responded, "I tell you this, if they keep quiet, the very rocks themselves will cry out in praise."
Him a total commitment in being a disciple.
In our Palm Sunday Gospel reading, we read of that familiar incident of Jesus entering into Jerusalem with the crowd shouting and proclaiming him king. The crowd believing that Jesus has now come to Jerusalem not to suffer and die, which was the appointed role of the Messiah, but they think he's coming to throw out the Romans. And so they're extremely excited. But we want to go back before that to when Jesus is with the disciples and they're by Bethage. And he sends two of the disciples to acquire a donkey and a colt. Now the demonstration of these two disciples, who were not named, shows us those three actions that we need to follow to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. And what we will notice as we examine these this morning is that these actions are not difficult, but actions each one of us can easily do in our daily lives in order to be totally committed to Jesus Christ. So we go back to that 21st chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, and we focus in on verses 6 and 7. In verse 6 we read, the disciples went. The disciples went. Jesus asked them to go someplace, and they went. The word went literally means to depart for a destination or a location, or it means to go. And what we notice about the disciples is after Jesus tells them where to go, they don't argue with him. They don't say, oh, Jesus, I don't like donkeys. Sometimes they bite and kick. Why don't you send so-and-so to go instead? And we don't see him making excuses. We don't say, well, Jesus, that's kind of a low job to go fetch a donkey. Why don't you send Judas and John, somebody else? That's below me. No, Jesus tells them to go when they go. And that is what we are to do. When Jesus tells us to go somewhere, we don't argue. We don't make excuses. We go. A disciple goes wherever and to whomever Jesus directs him. Now sometimes Jesus may not direct you to go very far. May direct you just to go to a neighbor's house who's not going to church. He may direct you to go no further than the corner market, where you can invite the store owner of the market to come to church. Or he may send you far away. Like the doctor who Jesus called to go to Pakistan to do a missionary practice in a village in Pakistan. Now, Pakistan is one of those nations where you can be killed for being a Christian or trying to make others Christian. But the doctor felt Jesus calling, and he went. And so he set up his practice, and he began to become friendly with all the villagers, so they trusted him. And one night he gathered them all together, and he told them the story of Jesus. And the crowd listened. And they were intrigued at Christ's teaching about love and forgiveness. They were deeply moved by his compassionate ministry. They were stirred at the mention of our Lord's death and resurrection. And when the missionary was through telling the story of Jesus, telling that old, old story of Jesus and his love, one of the villagers stood up and asked him the question. He said, Doctor, when did this happen? Did this happen just 10 or 15 years ago? The missionary doctor responded by shaking his head and saying, no, my friend, it didn't happen 10 or 15 years ago. It happened nearly 2,000 years ago. With that, the villager dropped his head, and a sad look came upon his face, and he asked, what terrible things have we done that God should have kept this wonderful word from us for so long? What have we done so wrong that God would keep this word of salvation from us It wasn't that the village had done anything wrong. It was the church, somewhere in its evangelizing in the early years, did not answer the call to go to Pakistan. For some reason, they stopped in India and did not go on to share the good news. See, as a disciple of Jesus, we are called to go. To go wherever Jesus directs us to go. And so they did. We then read, the disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. Had directed means to make something, or to make it happen. Means to produce some kind of result. It means to bring something forth that is intended to happen. And so the disciples did what Jesus desired them to do. They did the job of bringing a donkey and its colt to Jesus so that he could fulfill the Old Testament prophecy that said the king would come riding on a colt, the foal of a donkey. They did. A disciple today does what Jesus desires, not what he or she desires. Now, in the 1990s, some of you may remember, there was a lot of discussion in our national church about a shortage of pastors. The congregations were vacant and didn't have a pastor to fill the vacancy. So that's what we thought. But one day, I went to a meeting in which was not a synod assembly, it was a meeting in which there were pastors from other synods there, including from places like Minnesota, from Chicago, from out in Berkeley, where our Pacific Seminary is. And this topic was brought up about the shortage of pastors. And I sat there in amazement to hear these pastors say that in reality, there was not a shortage of pastors. That in Minneapolis, St. Paul, in Chicago, in Berkeley, down at Southern Seminary, Columbus, there were graduates of seminary. Graduates who were looking for a call. The problem was, they wouldn't take the call that was offered. They didn't think it paid enough. Or went in the state where they wanted to be. See, when I entered seminary, I entered at the tail end of what was traditional seminary life. And that was, you went to college, and then you went directly to seminary. So that by the time your seminary instruction was over, you were about 26 years old when you graduated. Some guys would be a little older if they got drafted or had joined the military right out of high school, or maybe dropped out of college for a couple of years, joined the military to help pay for school. But the majority of us would be around 26 years old. And when I was coming out, it was still the days of you went to what was called a first call parish. Every synod had certain congregations that were designated as first call. They usually were about 50 people. And they would be able to pay you the synod minimum. And you would stay there for a couple of years, and then you'd move on to a bigger congregation. Usually that didn't always happen. There was one congregation in Indiana where the fellow came there for his first call and ended up staying for 45 years. And, of course, over that time, the church grew into being much bigger than a first call parish. But that's just the way it was. I remember I was preparing to graduate from Hama. And at first my bishop was telling me he was going to send me to Richmond, Indiana. Because for some reason, the bishop we had in Indiana, Kentucky Synod, had this thing of if you were from Kentucky, he only sent you to Indiana for your first call. And if you were from Indiana, he tried to send you to Kentucky. And I never quite figured that one out, because someone from Fort Wayne or South Bend or Gary, Indiana, sure did not know how to live among the diehard UK fans in Bowling Green, Kentucky, or Richmond, or Lexington, or Paducah. They might have survived the bull, but the other parts where there were Lutheran churches, not too many Hoosiers were prepared for that culture shock. But anyway, they told me I was going to go to Richmond, Indiana. And then suddenly, about 3 weeks before graduation, he said, no, you're going to Evansville, Indiana. So I graduated from seminary. Gene and I had Aaron, who was two, and Joelle, who was one, and we moved to Evansville. Didn't argue, didn't make excuses. We went. That's what you were supposed to do. Well, this college found that there were students who just were not taking the assignments they were given. And part of the reason I was talking about things were changing, part of the reason, and this was the beginning when I was in seminary, seminaries were beginning to have a lot more what we call second call people. People who spent a career in the military. Or maybe they'd spent several years as a teacher, or a lawyer, or a CPA, a plumber, an electrician, any kind of vocation or profession. And for some reason later, like they felt the call to go into the ministry. And so these people would come in at an older age. They would come in with older children, junior high age, senior high age, not toddlers, infants like our boys were. And so they would expect more money than a bigger church just because they were. I can remember the old Lutheran magazine, which now is called Living Lutheran for some reason, but when it was the old Lutheran. And 1 month it had a picture of a recent graduate from seminary, a young lady. And the title on the cover was "The Numbers Don't Add Up." And in the article it talked about how she interviewed for her first call. And they offered her a package, which covered her insurance and all the things that you have to cover in order to have a pastor at the ELCA. And she took it home, and she and her father, as she said, crunched the numbers. And the numbers just didn't add up to what she thought they should be. So she turned to holiday. And so she wondered why she was sitting there with a degree from seminary and not the pastor of a church. So you don't tell a bishop no on your first call. Now, if you've been around for a while, you ask the pastor one day, and say, you know, if you've been around for a while, then you can tell the bishop no. But you don't come out of seminary to the bishop if you're not taking the first call, unless you want to be on his unknown and forgotten list. So these people were not doing what Jesus did. They wanted. I remember I had an intern like that. The intern had been in some kind of career for years, and when they were graduating, they thought they were going to walk into a church like Springfield Lutheran, which were. I was senior pastor. We were averaging, when I got there, we had about 135. By the time she was our intern, we were averaging 250 and having Sundays regularly. We were getting that Sundays of 280 and 290. So when she thought she'd walk into a church just like that right out of seminary, I sat her down and I told her, you don't walk into a church like this right out of seminary. You won't be able to handle it. The seminary didn't teach you everything. A lot of things you learn by trial and error. So a good disciple does what Jesus asks. You're called to do God's will, not your will. A convert to Christianity in the Congo wrote this prayer after their conversion. They said, quote, "Dear Lord, you give me the needle and I be the thread. You go first and I will follow wherever you lead." That is the attitude of a disciple of Jesus. Jesus leads, as the apostle tells us in the 12th chapter of Hebrews. Now, Jesus is the author and perfecter of our faith, the pioneer, the trailblazer, who set the way and we follow. And so the disciples did what Jesus asked. So we go and we do. And then the third action is we accomplish. They brought the donkey and the colt. That word brought means to lead gently without violence. As followers of Jesus Christ, we lead people to faith in Christ. We don't force them to become believers in Jesus Christ. There is a world religion whose founder conquered many areas, and its slogan was convert or die. That is not the message, the slogan of the Church of Jesus Christ. We proclaim and let the Holy Spirit work. We proclaim and let the Holy Spirit bring that person to faith. For those of you who remember confirmation class, study Luther's catechism, remember when we studied the creed, we came to the third article of the creed, which, for those of you my age and older, would have said, I believe in the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body and life everlasting. Amen. Where today we say, I believe in the Holy Catholic Church, meaning universal church, small c. Well, Luther's explanation, or part of that explanation is, I believe that the Holy Spirit has called me through the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, sanctifies and keeps me in the true faith, the same way it calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies the whole Christian church on earth. How many of y'all remember that? Okay, got one. Nobody else remembers that explanation. That is not for me. Well, that explains the work of coming to Christ in faith. We proclaim the good news. The Holy Spirit then calls that person through the proclamation of the gospel that you're making. And the Holy Spirit gives that person gifts. So we lead a person gently to faith in Jesus Christ. And let the Holy Spirit then accomplish the final task. But we accomplish the task of proclaiming the gospel, of sharing that good news with people. We don't force, we don't demand. We proclaim. During World War II, a church in Strasbourg, France was destroyed, so thought. Nothing could be seen remaining except a heap of rubble and broken glass. And so the people began to clear away the masonry and the broken glass so that one day they could rebuild their church. As they took away the masonry and the broken glass from one area of the church, they discovered a statue of Jesus Christ still standing upright. And the only damage to that statue was Jesus' hands were missing. And so the people rebuilt the church, and the statue stood where it had been for the original church. As they were rebuilding the church, a sculptor came by one day and told the church that he would gladly make new hands for Jesus and attach them to the statue so that you would see Jesus with his open hands inviting us to come and serve him. And so the church met and they took up the sculptor's generous offer. He wasn't going to charge him a thing, not for supplies, nothing. He just wanted to do this as a gift. And then finally, after much discussion, the church decided to turn down the generous offer to the sculptor. When he asked why, they gave this response, quote, our broken statue touches the spirits of people, but that he has no hands to minister to the needy or feed the hungry or enrich the poor except our hands. He inspires, we accomplish. That is the third action of a disciple of Jesus Christ. We accomplish, we perform for the glory of Jesus Christ. Not for our glory, not so that we can stick in our chest and
pump our chests and let's say, look how many people we brought to Jesus. We do it for the glory of Jesus. So as we celebrate this Palm Sunday today, we remember his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. We remember the start of his last full week of earthly ministry. On this day, as we remember that triumphal entry, we also recognize Jesus as our Lord and Savior, and that he is the Lord and Savior of the world. On this day also, we learn from the actions of those two unnamed disciples, learning from their action what it is to be totally committed to Jesus Christ, what the actions are that we are to do each day as a follower of Jesus. Going, doing, and accomplishing. All in the name of Jesus. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Those who can, please rise. Please join me in Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified and upon his Father. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
As we journey to Easter's fountain of life, let us pray for the world, the church, and for all people according to their needs. Our response today is, Lord, have mercy. For the church, that its life and mission may be renewed in the celebration of Jesus' death and resurrection, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all preparing for baptism at Easter, that they may follow Christ in the journey from death to life, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the leaders of the nations, that they may strive to serve their people in humility and without self-interest, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who are sick or dying, that their suffering, they may know that God is with them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our community of faith, that following the pattern of Jesus, we may empty ourselves from the sake of those who are poor, vulnerable, or in need, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We give thanks for all the saints who have walked in the way of the cross. Bring us to them to the endless joy and victory of Easter. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Hear our prayers, O merciful God, as we eagerly wait the day of resurrection. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
time for our offering. Pastor is now preparing the elements of Holy Communion. The body and blood of Jesus Christ will receive the true living body and blood as God makes the elements alive in us. Jesus gives himself to us as he has promised. This is Sunday, April the 9th, the Sunday of the Passion, Palm Sunday. We thank you, God, that you have endless love for us human beings. And you sent Lord Jesus Christ to take our nature and to suffer death on the cross. You have done this for yourself. You are God. And you have done this for us because you love us, giving us a second chance. Today we take that second chance. We receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ. We receive eternal life. We receive the resurrection gift, Jesus Christ. We follow him. We're forgiven by his blood. This is God's method of giving us a second chance. How can we turn this down? How can we turn down eternal life here we have offered to us today? In your mercy, enable us to share in his obedience to your will and the glorious victory of his resurrection. Christ lives and reigns with you and with the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Watch the rest of this on YouTube, and you can virtually receive Holy Communion. You can ask Jesus to come into your life, take over your soul, become one with him. Love God, repent, believe, love God, love your neighbor. We have all these opportunities that God gives us. This is Holy Week. We have the week of the Passion, which Jesus passively accepts God's will. We now have the ushers going forward with the offering plates, offering up, and then we will have Holy Communion.
Again, after supper, he took the cup,
Give thanks and give it for all the great saying. This cup is a new covenant in my blood shed to you for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore, O God, with this bread and cup, we remember the life of our Lord offered for us, and believing the witness of his resurrection, we await his coming in power to share with us a great and promised peace. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. So now we pray, O Holy Spirit, that we who share in Christ's body and blood may live to the praise of your glory and receive our inheritance with all your saints and light. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Join our prayer for those of your servants of every time and every place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest, until he comes as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus called us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated.
This Palm Sunday, the Sunday of Passion Week, beginning Holy Week, as Jesus accepted God's will to shed his blood for us, we have our second chance. God is purely good, does not tolerate sin. We messed up, we sinned, and now we have a second chance. And we receive Jesus' body and blood. He is within us, true body and true blood. And this is Jesus' call to us in love. He loves us enough that he shed his blood, and we're now free from sin, and we can live forever with God throughout eternity. Hymn was written by Robert Lowry, who lived 1826 to 1899. What can wash away my sin? This is a hymn in honor of Holy Week. Nothing but the blood of Jesus washes away our sins. And the music is also written by Robert Lowry. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Yeah.
Thank you for watching us on YouTube today. Thank you for participating in the forgiveness of sins that Jesus has given to us. As we are now free from sin, we have the blood of Jesus who has saved us, made us white as snow. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. We receive this as a free gift from God. The flowers on the chancel stands today are to the glory of God, presented by Donna Peer in honor of Ryan, Jordan, Keegan Anderson's birthdays. Three birthdays, beautiful flowers today. Also the palms, because this is Palm Sunday. This is the Sunday of the first Sunday of Holy Week, Jesus' Passion, as he was passive in doing as God wished. He was also God. It's very mysterious, very difficult for us to understand, but we have to receive it because God loves us. We thank you for worshiping with us. We invite you to come Holy Week, if you are able to listen to this in time. And Holy Week, we have Maundy Thursday, 2 o'clock, and 7 o'clock service. Good Friday, 2 o'clock, and 7 o'clock service. And then on Easter Sunday, we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We participate with him in his resurrection. We have a second chance. We messed up. We sinned. God can't tolerate sin, but he gives us a second chance. And now we're sinless through Jesus' blood as he died for us. This is God's way of showing his love to us as he himself died on the cross. He is all three in one, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. He's God, he's Jesus, he's the Holy Spirit. We accept all this. We know that God loves us, and we can feel the warmth in our hearts. We invite you to come any Sunday, 8 o'clock, worship service, 10:30 worship service, 9:15 Sunday school, and 6:30 worship service in the chapel, where we again receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. As he enriches us, he becomes real. He becomes alive within us. This is the miracle of the Holy Communion. How can we turn this down? Eternal life with God. So thank you again for worshiping with us. We invite you to come any time, worship with us. We invite you to invite Jesus into your heart. Make him Lord of your soul. Make him Lord of your life. Repent, believe, love God, love your neighbor. God will help you to do this. All you have to do is ask. All you have to do is knocking at the door, waiting for you. How can you turn down such a promise that we can be one with the ruler of the universe and have happiness, joy, and thanksgiving?